Today, the one who doesn't separate himself from us but meets us in our very need. Come on. Can't go back to the beginning. Can't control what tomorrow will bring. But I know here in the middle the place.
place where you promised to be.
In this concrete block room as a student pastor in a small church in Alabama. And I was playing this song on a boombox, right? It's like, remember we used to push eject and the tape would come out, and we were listening to this album, and this song called We Fall Down came on, and we sang it, and I just felt like the Lord was in the room. His presence was all around. I looked around, and there's students, and there's just the metal folding chair had tears in the bottom of it because we were all kneeling down and just crying. And there's been times in my life where I've remembered that, because the Lord's presence isn't always that strong, right? And I remember there was a verse that I just latched onto in that time, and it said, "One thing I have desired of the Lord, that will I seek, to behold the beauty of the Lord all the days of my life." And I wonder if that's the story is it always like that? Because this doesn't feel like, for me, every day is like just the presence of God just washing over and that some magical experience, right? It's more faith-oriented. But today, after we sing that song, that's how I want it to be every day. And I'm reminded of that scripture. One thing I have desired of the Lord, that will I seek. And so this may be your prayer, but it's going to be my personal prayer today. And I would just ask that you would just join us. And Lord, would you in this moment make you the desire of our heart? Whether we're here seeking out just who you are and just wondering, or whether we're just full of faith and full of love for you, God, would you show us in the next few minutes who you are? Would you just wash over this place? Would you set a fire in this place for your glory, only for your glory, Lord? It's in Jesus' name.
That I can't control, 'cause I want more of you, God. I want more of you, God. So set a fire down in my soul that I can't contain, that I can't control, 'cause I want more of you, God. I want more of you, God. Come on. Set a fire down in my soul that I can't contain, that I can't control, 'cause I want more of you, God. I want more of you, God. So set a fire down in my soul that I can't contain, that I can't control, 'cause I want more of you, God. Yeah, I want more of you, God. So set a fire down in my soul that I can't contain, that I can't control, 'cause I want more of you, God. lie down in my soul that I can't take, that I can't control. Cause I want more of you, God. I want more of you, God. Yes. Walking around these walls, yeah, I thought by now they'd fall, but you have never failed me yet, and you never will, never will. All waiting for change to come, and knowing the battle. Stands. Your promise still stands. Great is your faithfulness. Your faithfulness. I'm still in your hands.
out of me this morning that says that your promise, it still stands. God, we thank you today that your promises are true and we can find hope. We can trust in that. We find hope in it because we believe in the one who made the promise. A promise is only as good as the one making it, the one giving it. And you have been true and you have been faithful and you have been good, even in the times where we weren't feeling it. God, today, no matter what we're bringing in, we can trust in your promises, in your word, that it is good, it is true, it is for us. So God, even in this moment, we claim those promises. You've given us a hope. You've given us a future. And it's in your name that we sing and we pray and we do all these things. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Wow. Okay, you guys have a seat. And we are so glad that you are here with us today. Y'all, it's summertime. It feels like it's summertime. Who's happy that summer's here? Can I get an amen in the house? My kids got out of school Thursday. We were so excited about them getting out of school. I'm not going to lie. Last night I Googled, when do they go back? If you're a parent, you know exactly what I'm talking about. We are full-time event planners and coordinators for the next couple months. But we are so glad. We're glad that you are here today, especially if you're a guest with us. We just want to say welcome. We hope you just feel at home and feel comfortable here today. I want to welcome everyone watching online. We know a lot of people are traveling this weekend, and so we're glad that you're joining us as well. If you are a guest, there's a place in the lobby. You might have walked past it. It says Info Center. And there's just a new here sign. We've got some volunteers out there who would love to get to know your name and a little bit of your story and how to take next steps here at CrossPoint. The other thing I would say is maybe you've been coming for a while, but you're like, man, I think I'm ready just to take next steps. That's what that info center is for. Anything you need to know about CrossPoint, whether it's our kids, our students, serving, global good, local good groups, all that stuff, you can find all that information at the info center. So again, if you're kind of ready to like, man, I've been here for a while, I'm ready to take a step, that is your place to do it. I'm going to go ahead and invite our greeters forward as we receive our offering. Again, this is just a time that we give just out of the abundance of our hearts of what God is doing as an act of worship. And I just want to say thank you for those that partners. We partner together financially. Here's what I understand. Sometimes we give, and we give from a sacrificial heart. We give out of obedience to Christ. We give with joyful spirits. We do all those things. But we're just conditioned in our minds and our hearts to think about return on investment, right? When we give, this is the way we're wired. Like, is this making a difference? Where is this going and what is it accomplishing? And it's why I love what we got to witness last week. Because when we give, we're giving towards life change. We're giving towards good in the world, not just inside the walls of our buildings, not just online, but as we take this out and we take hope to the world, we're giving that. We can do more together than we do alone. And last week, we had a really tangible, physical example of why we give and why we do this. Y'all, get this. This just blows my mind. I'm still not over it, and I hope I never get over it. Last week, 167 people took a step in baptism last week across all of our campuses. Man, that's worth giving God glory for. God, we thank you. And what I love about it, we just need to be careful that we don't celebrate number, because it's not about the number, but each one of those numbers represents a life and a story and a family and a set of circumstances. And so we celebrate each one of those individually. And last week before Pastor Kevin, or during his talk, he baptized Bloss. You might remember Bloss and his story. Just an incredible moment we got to share as all our campus, just kind of a one church experience. But Bloss's story is so good that before defining moments, we wanted you to hear just like the full scope of his story today. So before we dive into our last week of defining moments, here's the rest of Bloss's story.
So my name is Bloss Hernandez, born in Oxnard, California. Right after high school, it kind of took me a minute to figure out what I had wanted to do next. I ultimately decided on joining the Army in 2008, served 9 years in a staff sergeant position. In 2009, I came down orders on Fort Campbell, Kentucky with the 101st Airborne Division, probably one of the most historic military divisions in the Army. I would say they're the New York Yankees of the Army, right? So there's a sense of pride that you kind of carry. From there, I built a lot of connections, and you know, one of those being John. So the moment leading up to April 22nd, 2011, there's one significant memory that I remember about John. It was 2 days before I remember crossing paths with him, and he had just kind of pulled me to the side and told me like, hey, you know, I heard you're about to get promoted, like this and this. I just wanted to tell you, like, keep doing what you're doing. Like, you know, I'm very happy for you, but I'm proud of you, man. Keep going. My team was the first to respond on that night when we approached the building. Just started firing back, He was still laying on the ground, you know, while we were fighting. It was at that point where we just started working on wounded casualties. It was about 9 total that night. It was my job to try and stabilize him and just work on him, but it was too late. From there, I'd got orders from my medic to cover his face with a blanket. I mean, I refused to do it. Obviously, him being a mentor, I didn't want to accept the fact that he was gone, but went ahead, picked him up. Well, you know, fire's still going. Evacuated him to the helicopter, loaded him up, and got him on the bird. It was hard for me because anytime a male, you know, who's either is higher ranking of me or older than me takes a personal interest in my life, definitely means a lot to me because I grew up without a father. So for him, you know, kind of saying those things that, you know, you wish your dad would tell you and telling you he's proud of you, and then losing him 2 days later, I had felt like I had gained somebody and lost somebody. But I didn't lose him. He's with me every day. I wear his name on my brace. And he's a constant reminder of how lucky I am, you know, to still be here. Looking back on it, I knew things weren't gonna be the same for me. But what I didn't know is that I'd be reaching out to God, you know, for guidance. So I just said a small prayer. I just said, help us carry out, you know, the mission from here on out, and just bring us all home safe. God, if you fulfill this promise, and if you deliver on this, like, I promise to build a relationship with you and get to know you. When it came down to just choosing where, you know, I would take this next chapter in my life moving forward, it was a no-brainer. I knew Nashville, you know, was the right place for me because I was deployed out of here. You can imagine John's memory is all around me. It was just a way for me to just be the person that God intended me to be. I was actually connected through CrossPoint by a good friend of mine, Robbie, and then Christina. She kind of found out that I was into filmmaking and stuff like that, so she invited me to a creative meeting where I met Ashley and JT. I went ahead, got on the creative team. I had been volunteering for, I would say, about 7-8 months now, and I remember just, you know, being on camera four, just before Easter service, and seeing Jordan Headley just on stage sitting down, and I just kind of walked up to Jordan and gave him like a big hug from behind. He just kind of looked up and was like, "What's up, buddy?" And he's like, "Have a seat." Started out with kind of small talk. The next thing you know, I just remember Jordan asking me, "So are you telling me you're ready to give your life to God?" In 2011, when I came home, I had every intention of fulfilling that promise. I just didn't have a support group around me like I do today. Being surrounded by Ashley, Aaron, the rest of the camera team, just gathering inspiration from each and every one of them, I have no reason not to succeed in my faith. I feel like I've been protected the entire time when I decided, you know, to ask God, you know, to protect me. He's undefeated. He's undefeated. Anytime I've reached out to him, anytime I've truly asked him for something, he's delivered. So I made the decision to get baptized. I know this is my opportunity to share, you know, what he's done inside me and what he's done for me. You know, I hope that my story is able to connect with, you know, just anybody, you know, just one person, and this will all be worth it. So this baptism, not only is this a celebration or a way for me to just kind of let the world know, like, hey, you know, I'm a follower.
You know, on this Memorial Day weekend, we honor John and all those who have given their lives in service to our country. And so this weekend, I hope you get time to relax and maybe do a cookout, spend time with friends, but also make sure you set aside some time to remember and to be thankful. You know, I'm also thankful that we all got to witness a defining moment in Vla's story last week. We actually set up all the baptism tubs at our campuses this week in the hopes that we might experience some more defining moments this week. You know, it's given me the opportunity to wrap up this series to be thinking about my own story and my own defining moments. You know, I grew up in a military family, and so we moved around a lot. That was certainly part of my defining moments. And my choice of college, I went to Oklahoma City University a little private school, and it's going to blow you away. It's in Oklahoma City. And there I made some lifelong friends. There's a group of guys that they are still, like, they're brothers to me, and we see each other every year. But that's not the biggest part of the decision. That choice of college directly led me to my first job, which directly led me to move to Nashville, which directly led me to meet my wife. So everything about those decisions really worked out beautifully for me. And certainly, I have two daughters, and so their births are defining moments in my life. Becoming a pastor here at CrossPoint about 6.5 years ago was certainly a defining moment. It's not something I ever really saw for myself, but now I look back, and though there was a risk to it at the time, now I can't imagine having chosen anything else. I'm really grateful that I get to be on this journey with all of you guys. Now, here's the thing. Some of these defining moments of my life, I knew what was going on. Like the morning of my wedding, when I woke up that day, I knew, like, well, this is it. This is a big day. This is a defining moment in my life. But if you back up just a bit from that and you go to the day that I met my wife, what's true is that I had no idea what significance that day was going to hold. I had no idea what a big day that was in my life. I've told the story before. I was on tour with a band at that particular time. She was a friend of a friend who tagged along to come to a show. And when I met her at the bus that morning, there was nothing in me that said, that is my future wife. I had no idea. I wasn't ready. I didn't put any thought into my first impression. I didn't put any thought into what I was going to say and what my joke was going to be and be charming and all those things. I'll be honest with you. I'm not certain I was wearing a clean shirt. Like, I lived with six other guys in a three-bedroom apartment. I don't remember us owning a washer or dryer. And though I'm sure I did laundry at some point in those 4 years, there's at least a 70% chance I had a dirty shirt on the day I met my wife. I think sometimes that's God in his goodness just telling her, like, hey, I think it's important you know what you're getting into here. So, but yeah, I wasn't remotely ready for that. But what's interesting is I actually have a photograph from that day, from the day that I met my wife, on the back of the tour bus, group of people. That's my wife there in the corner, and that young guy with his head resting on her shoulder. Go ahead and zoom in. That's not me. I'm not in the picture. That was true physically. It was also true metaphorically. I was not in the picture at all. It's funny, people have asked over the years, this, you know, asked my wife, you know, was it love at first sight for you guys? And it's really inspiring how fast she says no. Like, that's it's really gratifying. Now, it worked out for me, but I had no idea how significant that day was going to be. It was a defining moment in my life, and I could not have been more clueless about it. And the unfortunate thing in this life is that's true for a lot of my defining moments. That for the most part, the only way we know that one has even happened is that we see it in the rearview mirror. That it's only in hindsight we're able to look back and see the significance of the moment we were in. It's like the great theologian from The Office, Andy Bernard. He said, I wish there was a way to know you're in the good old days before you've actually left them. We know that's true, that we spot these defining moments in our life, but for most of them, we had no idea. Now, you've probably experienced this. Maybe you have a relationship. And where it is today, when you consider where it started, you would have never guessed where it is now, but it's a defining moment in your life. Or, you know, maybe unfortunately you're on the other side of that coin. Maybe there's been a relationship that ended, and it's something that you didn't ever see happening, and it's become a defining moment in your life. Or maybe it's in your occupation. Maybe it started off as a hobby, and then it became a passion, and then someday it became a career. It's so often these defining moments, they start slowly, 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 and then they happen all at once. You know, and I wonder sometimes also if I've missed out on some defining moments in my life. Like, I worry, are there somewhere, if I was going to use a baseball metaphor, that I let the pitch go by? You know, that step that I didn't take, that thing I said no to, that thing I ignored, is there potential that that was a defining moment in my life and I missed it because I just wasn't ready? And it got me thinking about this idea. What if there was a way for you to be prepared for a defining moment? Now, let me give a disclaimer. I don't know that I think you can force a defining moment to happen. I don't think you can overcome over someone else's free will and force that moment. And by that same token, I realize that some of our defining moments, they happen to us. And so I don't know that you can always avoid a defining moment. But what if there were changes that we can make in our lives, habits we could put in place, steps that we could take in the hopes that when a defining moment presents itself, that we would actually be prepared to step. And that's what I want to talk about today. And the good news is the Bible has a lot to say about that. You can find a lot of different stories, but there's a story I want to look at today, a story about a man named Nehemiah, and you find his story in the Old Testament. If we come over to the chalkboard, you can kind of see his whole story in a snapshot through his defining moments. It begins, he quits his job working for the king, and he rallies a group of people to join with him to rebuild the wall in Jerusalem that had been damaged. During that time, he escapes a plot of his enemies that almost certainly would have cost him his life. But when it's all said and done, he restores the people of Jerusalem to God. And it's a really incredible story. There's so many leadership lessons, so many things that you can learn from the story of Nehemiah. We could spend weeks and weeks and weeks, but for the topic I want to talk about today, this idea of how could we be more prepared for a defining moment, I actually think it's here, back at the beginning of his story, that there are some things that he does early on, and it's almost like my choice of college. That one decision sets off a chain reaction of other decisions. And so I think there is something about this defining moment that gives us clues on how we could be more prepared for a defining moment. And so let's take a look at that. If you've got your Bible with you, you can turn to Nehemiah chapter 1. I'll put verses up on the screen as well. But let me set the scene for you just a little bit. Nehemiah, it says he lived in the citadel of Susa, which is to say he lived in the palace of King Artaxerxes. This is the Persian Empire. You probably learned about him in history classes. This is a real person at a real time period. It was about 450 BC. And it says that one of Nehemiah's brothers comes through town and he has word about the condition of Jerusalem. Now, that's a big deal for a couple reasons. First, because the Israelite people, they had been exiled, kicked out of Jerusalem for about 140 years. And not just that, though, this palace where Nehemiah lives, it's about 750 miles away from Jerusalem. So updates on the condition of it is very, very rare. There are no new reviews on TripAdvisor to help him out with this. And so when his brother says, hey, listen, I've been to Jerusalem, seen it, it is a big deal. It gets his attention. And that takes us into the passage here with verse 3. It says, they said to me, those who survived the exile and are back in the province are in great trouble and disgrace. The wall of Jerusalem is broken down and its gates have been burned with fire. And when I heard these things, I sat down and wept. And for some days I mourned and fasted and prayed before the God of heaven. See, Nehemiah's brother says that some of the Israelites have begun to move back into Jerusalem, but it's not going very well for them. That the gates and the walls of the city have been destroyed, which means it is now an unsafe place to live. The enemies of the Israelites are able to come and go at will, but it's not just about their physical safety. Part of this also is just national pride, that the condition of the city is just a reminder of all that is broken about them and all that is lost, that their homeland is not what God intended it to be. And so these broken walls are a bit of a symbol to a broken people. And Nehemiah hears this news, and it absolutely devastates him. It says that he mourns, and he fasts, and he prays. And then he prays a really significant prayer. He begins with confession. He prays to God, listen, I understand and remember why we are not in Jerusalem. It's because of our sin. The sin is of our forefathers, the decisions they made. They turned their back on you, and as a result, they lost the promised land. I understand it is our sin that got us to where we are today. But he doesn't stop there. What's significant about this prayer is he then lumps himself in. He says, and it's not just them. It's not the people from the past. It's me. It's my sin. I have turned my back on you. I have not been all that you called me to be. I'm putting myself in this too. But then he makes a pivot. And in this prayer and in this pivot, he changes this posture. From this place of confession and brokenness, he then makes an appeal to God. It says in verse 11 there, Lord, let your ear be attentive to the prayer of this your servant and to the prayer of your servants who delight in revering your name. Give your servant success today by granting him favor in the presence of this man. So you notice, Nehemiah doesn't say, God, would you repair the walls of Jerusalem? And he doesn't say, God, would you send someone to go repair the walls of Jerusalem? From this place of brokenness and confession, he says, God, would you give me favor in the presence of this man? So what man is he talking about? You see it in the rest of verse 11. It says, I was cupbearer to the king. So this is the plot twist. This is when you get into scripture and as you read through it, if you take your time and you absorb some of the history, you see this really significant detail. Now we understand why Nehemiah is in the palace there in Susa. It's not because he's royalty, it's because he's a slave. But as a slave, he's got things pretty good. He's the cupbearer to the king. And what that means is that he tries all of the wine before it is served to the king. Now, I know for some of you, you're like, yeah, that sounds good. Sign me up. I'll be in on that. But I'll warn you before you sign up, there are some occupational hazards. One of the main reasons he's trying the wine is to make sure it's not poisoned. So when you had a bad day as a cupbearer, you had a really bad day. But there were a lot of perks too. You didn't just live in the palace. It meant that you would be in the presence of the king a lot. And so from that place, you might gain some influence with the king, and you might be a bit of an advisor to the king. So it was a really good position. But you didn't get to ask for favors. And so what Nehemiah is about to do is actually incredibly dangerous. But from this place where he spent time with God, he has the boldness that he takes the next step. And it picks up in chapter 2. It's a little bit of a long passage, but stick to me. I'm going to show you the part that I really want you to see. So Nehemiah talking in first person. He said, I had not been sad in his presence before. So the king asked me, why does your face look so sad when you are not ill? This can be nothing but sadness of heart. And I was very much afraid, but I said to the king, may the king live forever. Why should my face not look sad when this city where my ancestors are buried lies in ruins and its gates have been destroyed by fire? And the king said to me, what is it you want? This is the part I want you to see. This is the pivot. And I prayed to the God of heaven, and I answered the king, if it pleases the king, and if your servant has found favor in his sight, let him send me to the city in Judah where my ancestors are buried so that I can rebuild it. Nehemiah takes a huge risk by bringing this up to the king. But God is with him and grants him favor. The king gives him permission. He doesn't stop there. He also gives him supplies. He gives him security. Everything that Nehemiah asked for is given to him. And in this moment, he goes from being a cupbearer to a wall builder. Now, I want to pause the story here. Because already, just in this much of the story, the clues that I'm talking about, the clues that might help us be more prepared for our defining moments, they're already there. All you've got to do is reverse engineer what Nehemiah did in this, and I think it applies to our situations really well. And so let me point out one of the first things that I see if we're going to prepare ourselves for a defining moment. It's this. It's to pray first. Now, that's not a surprising thing for me to tell you. Prayer is something we've talked about a lot here at this church, and it's obvious if you're going to take on something big that you're going to want to pray first. But there's something significant about Nehemiah's prayer that I want to show you. That if I'll show you the whole prayer. I read you a short portion of this. I'm not going to read you the whole thing. It's a tiny font. Instead, I just wanted you to see, this is the body of the prayer as it's recorded in the book of Nehemiah. And inside of this, there are 44 direct references to God, either personal pronoun or one of his attributes. Attributes are part of his character, which is to say that Nehemiah in this prays a God-centered prayer. I want you to hold on to that, because here's what I'll contrast that with. If I'm honest with you, in my life, most of my prayers are me-centered prayers. God, help me with this. God, would you do this thing for me? Would you make this possible? Most of my prayers are me-centered prayers. And by the way, that's okay. Like, God cares about me, and he cares about you, and he cares about the things that concerns us. And so if you need me-centered prayers as a way to invite God into your life and into your circumstance, to share your heart with him, that is perfectly fine. I'm not saying that's a bad prayer. What I'm saying, though, is if we're trying to posture ourselves to experience a defining moment, then it's possible that the posture of our prayer matters as well. And Nehemiah was up against a monumental task, and so he needed a big God to turn to. Makes me wonder sometimes if the reason that our problems seem so big is because our God is too small. Like, I think we have to remember the God who created us, who loves us, who promises to be an ever-present help in times of trouble. The God who says that if we seek him first, that he will line everything else up for us. The God who is so vast that he says he can hold the world in the palm of his hand, but he's so personal that he knows how many hairs are on our head. There is nothing else in this universe that is both vast and personal at the same time the way that God is, and it's because he's a big God. He is bigger than the obstacles that we face. He is bigger than the things that we're up against. He's bigger than the things that scare us. He is bigger than the injustices that break break our heart, and he's bigger than the problems that we want to solve. Nehemiah had to build a big wall, and so he started praying to a big God. I think sometimes in my own life, the things I'm up against, the things that stress me out, they start weighing down on my shoulders. In those moments, I feel so weak. And then I'm reminded as I look to Scripture that what it says is that it's in my weakness that he can be strong. But there's an exchange that has to take place where I trade my weakness for his strength. And that happens in prayer. That's where we begin to function in his strength. So I think if we just want God to bless our food and bless our day, that's okay. He will. And we can keep praying those prayers. But if you want to posture yourself for a defining moment, I think the posture of our prayers matter. And I think we have to begin praying bigger, bolder prayers because he is a big God. He's bigger than the thing that scares us. And he's bigger than the injustice that we feel. In the face of an impossible task, Nehemiah turned to a God who was bigger than the thing that was impossible. The next thing I see in Nehemiah's story, if we want to posture ourselves to step into a defining moment, is this. Don't let fear steal your defining moment. Now, I look at Nehemiah's story. There's a little detail that's hidden in the story. It doesn't jump out at first glance, but it's there for a reason. If you look back to the text, when Nehemiah first talks to his brother and he hears about the condition of Jerusalem, it says that it is the month of Kislev. And then when he goes and he meets with the king and asks permission to go rebuild the wall, it says that is the month of Nisan. It doesn't give any other details. It just kind of throws those in there and keeps moving. And that doesn't mean much to most of us. But if you do just a little bit of study into the Jewish calendar, what you discover is that there's a four-month gap between those two dates. And what that means is that Nehemiah is so burdened by what he hears about the condition of Jerusalem that he mourns and weeps and fasts. And then for 4 months, he does nothing. And I don't think it's because he didn't have the opportunity to talk to the king. I think it's because he was afraid. And he had good reason to be afraid. And slaves don't get to ask the king for favors. And slaves don't get to come in to a meeting with the king with their own agenda. There was no agenda but the king's agenda. And so it was incredibly risky. He could have lost his own life. But Nehemiah didn't let that fear rob him of a defining moment. And you know, last week, Pastor Kevin talked a lot about courage as we looked at the life of John the Baptist. If you didn't see that, I encourage you to go back and spend some time on that. I'm not going to spend a lot of time on courage, but I will tell you this. Most of us are not going to find ourselves in situations like Nehemiah, where it's a life and death issue. But there are certainly plenty of things that we have to fear. There's the fear of change, there's the fear of regret, there's the fear of rejection, there's the fear of failure. And when God asks you to do something that is out of your comfort zone or out of character for you, it'll stretch you in a lot of ways. It'll stretch your resources, it'll stretch your talent, it'll stretch your time, it'll expose insecurities that you have, but you'll be in great company. Because God's word is full of all kinds of examples where God asks his people to take steps of faith even in the face of fear. He said, Moses, my people are being destroyed. Will you go? He said, Paul, the Gentiles need the hope of the gospel. Will you go? All throughout Scripture, we see examples of God inviting his people to take steps of faith, even in the face of fear. And so if we're going to be preparing ourselves for a defining moment, we can't miss out just because of fear. There's one more thing I want to see in this early part of Nehemiah's story, the pivot that he makes that changed everything about his story and that maybe holds one more clue for us in our stories, and it's this. Where you feel the burden, look for the assignment. Where you feel the burden, look for the assignment. Like, here's the truth. Nehemiah was not likely the first Israelite to ever feel a burden about the condition of Jerusalem. It'd been 140 years. Odds are there had been hundreds, maybe thousands of people who had felt that same burden, who sensed the injustice that they had lost their homeland, that they were exiled, that it wasn't the way that God had chosen it to be. And so he wasn't the first one to ever feel that. But the reason we're telling his story is that he's the one who stepped. He's the one who looked to God and said, okay, I feel the same burden so many others have, but do you have an assignment for me in this? I think sometimes the reason that a broken world stays broken is that we miss our assignments. That we feel the burden, for a whole variety of injustices and problems in this world. I know that we feel a lot of burdens because I've been on Facebook recently. I understand that we're venting and expressing opinions all the time about the things in this world that break our hearts. What I want to make sure is that we're not just doing that, but we're also taking the time to go, God, do you also have an assignment for me? Is there something that you would like me to do for this situation? Because what Nehemiah's story tells us is that God is looking for someone who's willing to play a part in stitching the world back together. It says it in 2 Chronicles. It says, for the eyes of the Lord move to and fro throughout the earth that he may strongly support those whose heart is completely his. What that verse is saying is that God is looking and he sees a lot of burdened people, but he's looking for the ones who are available. He's looking for the ones who are saying, you know what, God, I'm available if you'll use me. And for those people, God is looking to come behind them and to be like the wind in their sails, to carry them and to guide them, to prepare them, to equip them for whatever it is they need to do in the hope of beginning to stitch our broken world back together again. Because the truth of the matter is, where God's agenda is championed, his resources are channeled. That it doesn't become a thing where we have to have all the answers. We don't even have to have all the ability. Listen, there's not anything about being a cupbearer that prepares you to be a wall builder. That his skill set wasn't what was most valuable to God. It was his availability. It's his availability that matters. Now, that's not to say that God can't use those early lessons. It's not to say that there might not be something from your life that God could use to accomplish the thing in this world that he most wants to do. But what I'm saying is your availability is more important than your giftedness. Your availability is more important than what you've learned. It's more important than your strength. It's more important than your wisdom. It's more important than all those other things. Your availability is what God will most use to stitch this world back together. Now, because he's a good God, he brings those things together. You find purpose in it. I can look back into my music business days, and I find purpose of the lessons I learned there that equip me for being a pastor today. But what I know is that God wasn't sending me to the music business because maybe that's what would make me a pastor someday. It was my availability to him that led to the change and the pivot. And the same is true in your life. If you give your availability to God, he will come behind you and he will equip you. He will use your gifts. He will use your preparation, but he doesn't just need it. All he really needs is your availability. And looking for an assignment where you feel an injustice, it doesn't necessarily mean that you have to quit your job. And it doesn't necessarily mean that you have to move to a third world country. What it means is that when you feel the injustice, when you feel that burden, you ask the next question, and that is, God, is there an assignment you would give me in this? Because God has shown us that he'll use us to stitch the world back together. So that's one of the interesting things about Nehemiah's story. I spent all my time in this early part, the pivot, because I think this is my favorite part of the story. But this isn't the part of the story that most people tell. What most people would tell you is that the most significant defining moment of Nehemiah's life, it was right here. And it's when he rebuilt the wall successfully. And he didn't just rebuild it. He rebuilt it in 52 days, which was an engineering miracle. It was impossible. This is not a small wall. It circles the entire city. It was about 12 feet high and about 8 feet thick. It was impossible for him to build it this way, but he does it in 52 days. So it begs the question, so how did he do it? How did he take on this impossible task? Well, it was really clever. If you go to Nehemiah chapter 3, there's a long list of people and parts of the wall that gets defined there. But instead of reading it to you, I just want to show it to you. This is a graphic that kind of illustrates what the wall, the shape of the wall was like. And each of these names that you see, they're the roughly 40 or so groups of people that God used to rebuild the wall. Here's the special part. Here's what was really clever about it. The way Nehemiah did this is he had most of these people build the section that was in front of their house. Because he understood that what they were going to care the most about and where they would feel the most burden was the one that was most personal to them. And so he just recruited everybody to rebuild their section of the wall. And he did it. He did it in 52 days. It's how you take on an impossible task. You search for the assignment that God's given you, and then you start building your section of the wall. You know, I see this throughout my life in a lot of different ways. You know, a lot of us feel a burden for the condition of our schools and for the quality of our kids' education. We worry for our kids. We want to make sure the teachers are supported well. And a lot of us feel that burden But I have a friend named Jen, and she is the most involved parent that I've ever known when it comes to her kids' schools. She's on the PTO, and she's constantly recruiting parents to get involved, and she's always at the school helping the teachers. All the kids know her by name. She is a force of nature. And all she's doing is taking that burden that she receives and a lot of people have, and she's using it to rebuild her section of the wall. You know, I have a friend named Melvin that we've become friends over the course of this last year. You know, CrossPoint's experiencing a growing diversity across all of our campuses, and it's really gratifying to see. I love the church that we're becoming. And Melvin represents some of that growing diversity as an African-American man. And when Melvin and I met, it was an ordinary moment, as ordinary as it comes. We were on the same row. The worship leader said, say hi to your neighbor, and we obeyed. That's the whole story of how we met. But we started talking over the weeks that followed, and we ended up going to lunch together because Melvin has a really unique burden. That he looks at the relations between races in our country today, and he believes that it can be fixed. But where it can especially be fixed is with Christians who take the gospel seriously and choose to make the church a place where we are drawn back together, where we stitch back the thing that has come apart. Now, here's the great thing about a burden that is close to God's heart. Those burdens are contagious. And so as I talked with Melvin about it, that his burden became my burden too. And so from that place, we just started praying, God, what's the assignment? What would you have us do? So we decided to look to the scriptures. And so we launched a Bible study on the topic of racial reconciliation. Because we believe that diversity is a beautiful thing, but it can be circumstantial. That you can just happen to have different people in a room and still have no unity in the room. That reconciliation is an active process and it costs you something. And so we pulled a group of about 20 people together to engage a conversation of what does it really look like to reconcile in this world? And over the last few months, we've been having these conversations, and at times it's been beautiful, and at times it's been really uncomfortable. And it doesn't appear so far that we have fixed the problems of racism in this country. But we've started to rebuild our section of the wall. You know, a lot of us feel a burden for the poor, for the refugee. But I have friends named Daniel and Raina who feel that burden uniquely. Raina herself is an immigrant and remembers how difficult it can be to get a start in a new country. And so they've partnered with us here at CrossPoint as one of our local good projects, where most Saturdays they're going to a refugee community in South Nashville and they're serving the families there and playing soccer with the kids. And I'm willing to bet that they thought that that was the assignment that God had for them. But then they started hearing about a woman there in the community that was pregnant, and it became clear that she probably wasn't going to be able to raise the child. And so they prayed to God, is there more to the assignment than what we first thought? And God answered that prayer, because this is a picture of Daniel and Raina and their adopted daughter. And what they're doing is stitching the world back together. They're rebuilding their section of the wall. God used their availability and their willingness to heal something that was broken. Now, the good news in all of this is that my burden doesn't have to be your burden. And your burden doesn't have to be my burden. That God will give each of us a unique burden, I believe. And to the extent that we are ready for an assignment, that we look to him for an assignment, I believe he will use us in profound ways in our communities and in this city and throughout the world to begin to stitch back a humanity together that he never intended to be torn apart. I believe he will use us, that these burdens that we experience, they break our heart for a reason. It's because they break God's heart too. We started this conversation about 6 weeks ago. It began with Pastor Kevin saying this. He said, our life is the sum of the moments that we live, and we don't know when a defining moment will show up, but we believe that God will meet you in a way that after that moment, nothing will ever be the same. And that's what I want for my life, and that's what I want for your life too. So here's what we're going to do. We're going to pray. And we're going to pray big, bold prayers, believing that there are big, bold things that God wants to do in our world, in our community, and even in our church. And you know, we're not going to let fear rob us of a defining moment. We're going to take risky steps. We're going to go ahead, even in the face of the unknown, we're going to take steps. And as God gives us a burden for the things that burdens him, we're going to say, God, what is our assignment in all of this? Because the best defining moment isn't the one you experience by chance. It's the one that is God ordained. So with that, if you guys will stand with me, if all of our campuses will stand with me, I'd like to close in prayer. God, I'm so thankful for the truth of your word, that your character is the same today as it was thousands of years ago. So we can turn to your word and we can sense your heart for your people, your love for your people, but we can also see stories of people who have made a profound difference. And so God, my prayer is that we'll be available, is that we'll be a people that are not just feeling a burden for the things of this word, but that we see that we have an opportunity. And I pray you give us stories of breakthrough, stories of revival, stories of healing, stories of restoration and reconciliation, stories that would remind us that your word is true, that you will let us play a part as you heal this world, so long as we're available. I pray for defining moments. I pray for defining moments for all of us. Not for our sake, but for the sake of a world that desperately needs your hope and your touch. And so be with us as we leave this place, as we walk this out. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Thanks for being here. You guys have a great week. We'll see you next Sunday.